Hello.
Hello, welcome. This is an early Periscope. We normally do. Hi, welcome. Thanks for joining. We normally do our Periscopes at night, but I'm not able to do that today. So we're having it a little bit early. And today we're talking all about hermit crab shells. That seems to be a topic that comes up over and over again, and new crabbers always seem to really struggle with what kind of shells they should be buying. Where do I find shells? How do I measure my shells? Why won't they wear this shell? So, we're gonna look at good shells, bad shells, and how to measure shells, and then where to find shells. So, the bin I have in front of the camera right now is my small to medium good shells. So I'll just get some of those out and we'll just look at them to give you an idea of what we're looking for. I don't really have other than one painted shell. I don't really have any bad shells anymore. I used to have a whole bin of shells that were inappropriate that I used to use for demonstration purposes, but when I moved, I think that they got tossed. So I may have to put together another collection of what bad shells look like. But we'll look at some of that stuff online also when we get a little further into the Periscope. So welcome. Thanks for joining. If you have any questions, pop them up in the chat down below, which is just right down here. Feel free to share this out on Twitter. If right over the little person right there, you tap that, you can share this broadcast out to other people on your Twitter. Or I don't think there's a Facebook link. You got to copy the URL and go over to Facebook and post it and all that. But it's great if you can invite other people who like hermit crabs or are curious or just want to watch us talk about shells. So let's just jump in and start looking at my bin of good shells. So these right here, I'm gonna try not to bump the phone with my hand, and if I make somebody seasick, I apologize. These are nerite shells. I don't know all the names of all the shells. I just happen to know that these are nerites, and these are really small zebra nerites. Can we see well enough? That's probably a little better right there, right? These are what are considered a D-shaped opening because of the sort of flatter bottom part of the opening. So these are the type of shells that are typically preferred by Compressus or Ys. They like the D-shaped, but that's their preference. It doesn't mean they won't wear a shell with a round opening, and it doesn't mean that other crabs won't wear shells with D-shaped openings. They will wear whatever suits them at that time. What's available to them on the beach dictates what they wear and don't wear. You've probably seen pictures or videos of crabs wearing trash because there's no shells available to them. So they have to have some form of protection. So if they're in a terrible shell they found on the beach that really isn't to their liking and you put them in the tank with other options, they may immediately change. And then there's a lot of factors that weigh into how they choose their shells. The shell has to be heavy enough to protect them from predators and from drying out and allow them to withdraw completely and seal off the opening with their big pincher. But it also has to be light enough that they can move around easily with it, escape predators, climb trees. I just recently read a study that indicates that a heavier shell will slow the growth rate of a crab and make the females less fertile. And then the lighter shells are prone to breakage or drying out. So when they're choosing shells, they're weighing a lot of different options. So while it seems to us they may be very picky, they know what they're doing. They're trying to find the best shell for them. So anyway, these smaller shells, these are good shells, really common with ease. And then there's these these are Thai shells. That's all I know them by. These are more of a D-shaped opening also. See how the bottom is a little more flat and then rounded at the top? Another one that would be good for an E, which is also Compressus. If you hear me saying Compressus, that means Ecuadorian or E. Those are the crabs from the west coast of South America and like the tip of California, southern tip of California. Okay. So this next bag of shells, these are annoying to hermit crab owners because they're long, they're cumbersome, but there are species that do like these shells. These are preferred by violas, but I don't know if that's simply because that's what's available to them where they're at. My recent violas all came in another version of a pointy shell, and I don't know that any of them have changed out yet. This one has been well worn and drug around a lot. It's been modified at the top. You can see the crabs will chip away, break away the shell to modify it to fit them better. This one's had a lot of work done on it. So it was worn a long time. Look how smooth it is down here. He was dragging this bad boy around for a while. So while you might not understand why a crab would want one of these, they will wear them. Some species do like them. I'm trying to think if they're called like a top shell or, I mean, they're long spiral, but I can't remember the actual scientific name for them. So I keep some of those on hand just in case. Now let's look at just more common shells. These are pika shells. Pika, maybe how you pronounce it. Pika, pika. Magpies are also called. You'll see a lot of Caribbean, the purple pincher, wearing these. These are a round opening. They're a pretty heavy shell, but really popular. I think these are really common. That's why you see the Caribbeans in them a lot. And I have a lot of those. The next most common is the turbo shell. See how round this one is in comparison to the D-shaped opening? Let me grab another. This is also a D-shaped opening. So there you can see the difference, how the bottom of this one is more flat and this one's more completely round. So anything that you see that looks round opening, stripy, these are a very general class of shells just called turbos. I have all different varieties of turbo shells. And these can come in small to really, really large sizes. I'll show you some big ones. This one is slightly different. See how it's got the more noticeable like dashed coloring? But it still falls in the turbo family, in my opinion. So those are all good shells. These D-shaped opening shells, these are either a whale eye. I think these are the whale eye. This one's been worn. It's been modified and a crab has worn it. They don't seem all that popular. You would think they would be good shells for ease, but for some reason they just aren't super drawn to them. This one was also worn. You can see chipped away. This one is much thicker than this one. So I've had crabs wear these, but they just don't seem to gravitate towards them. These are another shell that's preferred by ease. I also have several kvipes wearing these. They also see have the flatter bottom, more of a D-shaped opening. I think these are a type of whelk. That's a bigger one of the nerites. And see how it's been, can you see where they've just worn it through back there? That one actually has a couple pinholes in it. While the pinholes aren't dangerous, it does reduce the humidity and moisture level in the shell. So it does introduce a chance for the crab to dry out. But if they're in your tank and you have a good humidity level, a pinhole shouldn't hurt a crab. And, you know, if you see when your crab's wearing a shell with a pinhole, you know, there's nothing you can do about it. That's the thing about crabs. If they're wearing terrible shells, the only thing you can do is offer them new shells. You can't make them change shells. Sometimes you can entice them by taking the shells and boiling them, letting them cool and putting them back in the tank or putting them in the tank. Sometimes it makes them kind of smell new and they'll check them out with renewed interest, but that doesn't always work. If you're going to boil shells that are already in your tank, triple, quadruple check that there is no crab in any of the shells. And then after you've checked four times, check one more time, then place them in a bowl with cool tap water. Let them sit for an hour. And then once you're sure again that there are no crabs in any of the shells, it's okay to boil them. I have no idea what the shell is called, but commonly worn also. I feel like this is somewhere between the D-shaped and the round. But not a pretty shell, but definitely okay to wear. These, whoops, we'll just leave that one on the floor. I have more. Babylonia shells are also really common. This is typically the ones that they're painting, which is kind of a shame because the crabs do like these. They come in lots of different sizes, but they don't get super large is the only problem. And again, you can see this one's been modified a little bit by the crab that was wearing it. It's kind of normal. It's another reason why you don't want painted shells. They pick at the shells. They eat at the shells to make them fit the way they want them to. These are pretty easy to find at most craft stores. I think this is a Thai shell that we already looked at. This is a white turbo. Can you see how this one's really, really, I guess it's still just as round as the turbo. I don't have good luck with these just plain white turbos for some reason. I don't know if it's because they're too thin because they've been ground down, but like this one was worn. You can see where it's got wear and tear, but they don't seem like they're very popular. If you look at most of my turbos, a minimum of three shells per crab and three different shells and maybe slightly varying sizes. I keep a lot more than that in there, and I think most people that have had crabs for a while also keep a lot more in there. We set aside pretty large sections in the tank to house shells, and the longer you have hermit crabs, the more you become a shell collector. I'm kind of still to the point that if I run across some shells in a store that look like a good selection, I'll grab them just in case. Sometimes I provide them to people who just can't find shells, that have a crab that's being really picky and they need something specific, or we put them in the prize bin. And we have some really gorgeous shells in the prize bin. I'll show those to you too before we get done today. So if you look at my turbos, most of them are really well-worn and modified. They're just a really popular shell. I feel like this is a type of Murex, like the pink Murex. These are good shells. This is the black Murex. This is a good shell, even with the pointy things on it. These are a little lighter. There's another type of what I believe is a Thai shell. It's kind of bumpy. Reminds me of a dinosaur. This is a really pretty tapestry turbo. These are also well-liked. A smaller, I don't know if this is a moon shell. I can't remember what all of these are called. This one has a hole in the little spiral. I'm just looking now to see if I have anything different in here. These are a different type of nerite. These don't seem to get as big. I do see compressus or ease wearing these. I think sometimes they have like a little bit of a ridge in here and the crabs have to kind of wear that down. And there's not much of a spiral. So there's not a lot of room in there. They can't really wrap their tail around the way they do in a shell like this that has a deeper spiral. But they just don't get very big, so they're not a great option going forward as your ease get bigger, because you just won't be able to find them. It's another kind of, I had an E in this one. These aren't super popular with other crabs, but an E will wear these. I think these are a type of whelk, maybe also. Not entirely sure on the scientific name. Here's another type of a nerite. Also a D-shaped opening for E's. These blue nerites are really popular. They've got really pronounced ridges in them. You'll see E's in these a lot. These must be really common along the coast where in South America. This one is, you can't really see it, but it's worn out pretty good. I had another one that was bigger. These also don't get very big, and the crabs had worn it down so far, which I'm sure they were just trying to make room because they were growing. And it just was too small, so they were trying to hollow it out to make more room. Here's one you can see. This one's really been modified. See how they've chewed away at the shell to make it fit better? Very industrious. I think that's a good variety. Here's another small little turbo. A lot of my little Caribbeans come in these. So I think that's a good look at this bin. I'll get the bigger shells out because there's a few differences in the bigger shells as your crabs get bigger. Normally we could do my tank, but I'm up on the second floor and the tank is down in the basement. And I would have to like run down two flights of stairs. If you want to see my tank, you can go back to any of our previous periscopes, and you can find our archive on the website catch.me/crabstreet, but it's catch with a K. My tank is in literally every other periscope I've done. You just happen to catch the one where we're doing something targeted, like shells. Normally, the entire periscope is in front of my tank with us looking at my tank, so there's definitely other videos out there. I have, for my shell shop, I have my small to medium is an upside down turtle dock that hangs. The thing is, those turtle docks were discontinued like many years ago, so you can't find them. The other one I use for the large to mediums is a pot liner, like a flower pot liner, one of those cocoa fiber liners. And it's like a 14-inch one, like a 14-inch diameter. So it's huge, but it's made out of cocoa fiber. So I have my large and medium shells in that, in the tank. And that works out pretty good because it's natural and they can climb the sides of it. And it still keeps the shells out of the substrate. Okay, so now I'm going to try to get... I don't think I can put the whole bin in front of us. So... there's a larger, these are Areolata shells, and these do get a little bit bigger than the Babylonias, so that's a little bit bigger one there. It's a turbo that's just been, it's been carved, but I've had this one for a long time, and it's dingy and got holes in it from being buried in the substrate over and over again. This is a monster black murex. Like, it is as big as my hand. And it is heavy. This will fit a very large crab. I feel like they're a little on the heavy side, but when crabs get this big, they have fewer and fewer options. So these are hard to find too. Shells this big are really hard to find. So definitely if I stumble across these monster shells, I grab them. I buy them so that I have them. You never know, somebody else might need one. Someday some of my crabs will be this big. So they're good. If you find them, snatch them up. This one is a bad one only because it has a clear coat put on it. When Earthbound Trading was still selling hermit crabs, the last trick they tried was to varnish all the shells with the stupid clear coat. So I bought this with a crab in it, and once he got home, he moved out of it. So clear coat, just as bad as paint. These are Large snail shells. I don't... That substrate stuck in there. I don't know that I've had a crab in one of these. By all appearances, it should be a perfect shell, but they're very thin. So I don't know if crabs avoid them because they're too thin. And the E's don't get this big, even though this is a D-shaped opening. A compressus won't get this big. So I still have them. In a pinch, a crab probably would wear it over having nothing at all. But they don't seem to be first choice. Here's a larger pink murex. Just to see. It's the same as the one covered in varnish, except that one's natural. I have several of those. Here's a great big jade turbo. These are expensive if you buy them now. They've gotten very expensive. Of course, that's a good option for a large crab. Here's one that's not polished. Also really good size. This one came to me with some adoptions several years ago. That's about the only thing I'll take from people when I'm doing adoptions is their shells. Just because I have started hoarding shells. Another really big green turbo, also not polished. This one you can see is really, I don't know if you can see how dull and bumpy it is, but if you get down here you can see that it's also a green jade turbo just like those are. It just hasn't been worn down. African turbo shells can also be a good option. For a long time, people would buy these and say, oh, my crab won't wear them, my crab won't wear them. Once I had a crab take one of these, he, you can see, this thing is rough. He wore this so long and buried in it so many times, like it's not soft at all. It's very gritty. I have another one too. This one is still smooth. I don't think it was ground down as much as this one, so there wasn't as much exposed. But these tend to be really expensive also. These can sell for like $18 a shell. And they're really pretty, but not necessarily necessary. Just because you paid $18 for it doesn't mean your crab's gonna wear it. There's a bigger magpie pika shell. Also a good shell. Here's another one that they took chunks out of. I mean, they really, when they wore these, they wore them for a long time. One of them, like this one, has all kinds of pitted marks in it, if you can see that. One of them they had worn a hole into. I keep this shell because this was my first E, and I had him many years before he had a rough molt, a couple of them back to back, and then ended up dying. But Wimbley wore this shell for, I would say, years. It did not have the hole in it to begin with, but he literally wore it so long that he basically wore a friction hole in the top of the shell. And then it broke down here also. I keep that one just out of memory, my little Wimbley. Most of these other shells are pink murex and turbos, just because that's all that's out there. Here's another black murex that's not quite as calcified as the other one. It's still big, but not as heavy. Like this one here really has a lot of, see the calcium buildup on this one? So this one's a lot heavier. So if you can find them without the calcium buildup, that's going to be a better option. Okay, so that's all of my shells. Let me show you some of the shells that we have in the prize bin, because I did take two jumbo shells out of my collection and add them to the prize bin in case somebody ends up needing really big shells. But entering our contest every month is a way for you to win some shells. So this one here, here's a bad shell right here. There's actually two of them in here. So these shells, not that one, should be considered good shells. They're turbos. But they have a gold liner inside of them. And for some reason, crabs won't wear these. I don't know what the difference is, if there's something in that gold lining that they don't like, but the gold mouth turbos, your crabs will not wear. Again, they might in a drastic situation where there's nothing else left, but given other options, they won't wear them. Okay, those are more turbos. Here's some more Babylonias. Some smaller white turbos. Some more Nerites, and a very little turbo. Some medium green jades, some small green jades. I also have these, and I've had hit and miss luck with my E's wanting to wear these. But again, E's are just picky. But we do have these. They're all D-shaped opening. They're kind of a medium weight. I find a lot of these have rough edges on them. But as long as it's not too jagged, it should be fine. Again, the crabs will modify them anyway and chip away at them on their own to make the shell fit them better. Some pretty turbos. I really, really like these turbos that they made polka dotted. They just ground away some of the covering to make the polka dots. These are all prizes. Okay, so here's one of the, this is a prize shell. This is a tauna shell. You can see, again, as big as my hand. It's very thin. Yeah, they'll chip away at this outer edge to modify it to fit better. I've never caught one doing it, but you can tell by the shells that they are doing it, and I know other people have seen their crabs doing it. But like I said, this is kind of thin, but the bigger the crab gets, the less choices they have. And I have seen pictures of crabs wearing these tauna shells. I've definitely seen Australian crabs wearing these, smaller versions of them. This one here is also a tauna shell. This one is bigger than my hand, so that's a massive shell. I can put my hand inside of this shell. So that's part of the prize pack too, in case somebody out there has a really, really jumbo Caribbean crab that needs a new house. Hopefully I'll have something to help them out. Okay, so let's look at, what do we want to do next? Do we want to see some pictures of bad shells? Do we want to look at measuring shells? No takers. Okay. Measure. Okay. That sounds good to me too. Let me grab a shell to measure with. So you can measure your shells with a ruler. I have a regular ruler. I have this fabric ruler that's a sewing ruler. And then I also have calipers. Calipers are an easy way to measure the shell as long as you understand how to read the caliper. And sometimes that's more trouble than it's worth. But I have them to show you. I did find it. It was in with my beads for some reason. I think I have another one for the shells, but I found this one in with my jewelry making stuff. So what you want to do is measure the shell that your crab is currently wearing, assuming it fits properly. And by fitting properly, the crab should be able to withdraw all the way into the shell. Its large pincher and outermost walking leg on its left side should form a impenetrable seal around the opening. So it becomes just a hard wall that no predator can get in or reach in around or get leverage. It should fill this perfectly. That's a perfectly fitting shell. In that instance, you can just measure across the opening with the crab in it and then order some shells slightly bigger. If they're in a too small shell, you're going to have to measure the opening and probably bump up quite a bit. They will wear shells that are too small. They will wear shells that are way too big. I have a Viola right now that's in a shell so big that when it withdraws all the way back, you can just barely see a hint of its big pincher down inside of there. So they'll wear lots of ill-fitting shells. So, oh, I shouldn't have done that. Look at the mess I made in my camera box. Oh, well. So you want to measure the widest part. Yeah. You want to measure the widest part of the opening. So I'm looking right there to right there. Now that's the widest projection on the shell, but I think up here is a little better. So the opening is, the actual opening itself is just a little bit over an inch. It's really hard to measure like inside here, but you can do that with calipers. But again, the crab needs to close off this outermost part. So it's okay to measure from the outer walls out here. Just make sure, and if you're not sure, kind of move. This is nice with the tape because you can just move it around and see where your widest point is and call that your shell size. And then when you're ordering shells, you'll want to go by the size of opening, not by the size of the shell itself, because that's not going to do you any good. So that's basic measuring with a ruler. With a caliper, this is the caliper. Normally the caliper is closed like this. And you have, make you guys seasick doing that, I know. It has the fixed numbers here in the middle and then the sliding scale. And we've got the inches on top and millimeters on the bottom. This top part is used to measure the inner diameter of something, like a shell, and the bottom is to measure the outer diameter of whatever it happens to be. So you can see that if we did this, we would be trying to measure out here like that. It's much easier to put this inside. Can you guys see that? All right, so I've got my, let's see if I can make it any, I feel like that's probably the widest point right there. So I can lay that down. And what you do is you find the zero on top, and you have to go back or right below it to the first measurement you see right there. So this one's like, I would say that's like 1¾ inches right there. That's how you get your first number. So you would write that down. And then you come up on the top and you have to look and see after the zero, where is the next mark on top that lines up perfectly with the mark below it? And that would be this one. So that's 1/16. So we would add that to the reading we took down here to get our actual reading using a caliper. If that doesn't make sense, and it probably doesn't to you, it took me a couple times. I have a page to show you that you can go and look up that'll walk you through it again. But that's how you use your calipers to measure the inner opening of the shelf. Okay, so let's go over to, we're going to go over to my computer. So hang on, we're going to move. Oh, there's my poster. It's framed, and I'm hoping to get it hung up today. But it is framed and ready to go here. All right. So here's the website on WikiHow on how to read a caliper. And I can put that, I need to put this as a link out on our website so that people can find that with the shell measuring. If you go to the Crabtree Journal, this is our website, you can come down here to this box that says Find Stuff and search for shells. And we have an article on how to measure your hermit crab shells with some pictures. These are painted shells, terrible. Then unsuitable shells. So these are a couple other shells because they're this one because it's covered in varnish. But I've also not ever seen a crab voluntarily wearing this type of shell. These delphinia shells are another. I don't know. It's like a clear coat. So I don't know if it's nail polish or if they sprayed like a clear varnish on them. These were at Earthbound Trading and like almost all the shells were like that. It was something dumb they were doing for a while. So these delphinia shells are also not good shells. These crabs were definitely forced into these shells. The spiral goes the wrong way. And the opening is also a little weird. Again, they will wear them if they have no other options, but they won't voluntarily put these on if they have other shells. So don't buy those. That's a Goldmouth Turbo. Again, not sure why they don't like the Goldmouth. This one, not acceptable because it's not deep enough. It just has nowhere for the little butt to go. Muffin shells are another shell that seem like they should be a good shell, but crabs just will not wear these shells, not if they have other choices. The Tectonicus, I've seen crabs wear these, like Violas, I think, but I wouldn't intentionally buy them because they're not a great shell, and they're bulky and hard to move around with. I think if you offer other shells, that the Violas would change out of these. These type of bonnet or harp shells that have these jagged teeth inside of them, not good shells. You might be able to bring those home, and if you have a powerful Dremel and some really good respiratory protection, buff those out, but probably not worth all that effort. I would just buy the right shells to begin with. Then we've got just another slideshow on here of all different kinds of suitable shells. As I get some more pictures, I'll try getting them uploaded. These are really old pictures of mine. There is a link to an old video that I did back in the day that's still on YouTube. This one may replace it. Some information about a gal that was making, Amy Youngs was the first person to try making prototype plastic shells. And then the MakerBot, that's becoming a little more popular. Oh, and then there's the god-awful glass shells. These are not suitable shells. These are not good shells. They're too heavy. I don't think crabs would voluntarily wear these. And then this is a little bit about an article about shells. A terrible story about painted shells and why you should not ever buy painted shells. The poor crabs. So lots of shell information on the website that you can go and check out. We also have on our Google Plus community, we now have a couple albums with shells in them that you can go and look at for good shells and bad shells. And if you are a member of that community, you're welcome to go on there and, oh, down at the shore, yeah. You're welcome to go in and add your photos here. That would be great if you have good or bad shells you want to add. You can also do that on our Facebook group, which is the Land Hermit Crab Owner Society. This is our Facebook group. You can join the group, and then we have a couple different albums for good and bad shells where you can upload your own shells to help people out. It's great when people, if they're looking for shells, it helps so much to have a picture to look at. So they know when they go to the store, this is good, this is good. And then as they learn why, it's a lot easier to pick them out for themselves. So where can we go and buy shells? We can buy shells lots of places online. As far as, and we'll look at, I'm going to show you some of those sites here in just one second. As far as like brick and mortar stores, actual stores, the shells that they have at Petco, PetSmart, are mostly bad shells. You won't, and they're overpriced. They're really overpriced. Any place that sells